verses 1 to 5, 1 Peter chapter 2. So get rid of all evil behavior, be done with all deceit, hypocrisy, jealousy, and all unkind speech. Like newborn babies, you must crave pure spiritual milk so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. Cry out for this nourishment. Now that you have had a taste of the Lord's kindness, you are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priests. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God. This is God's word. We believe with all our hearts that God will bless this. I have chosen this picture for our title page because you notice that the stone in the middle is the cornerstone. It is the Lord Jesus Christ. It represents him, the living cornerstone. And the surrounding stones represent us. We are living stones. Jesus is the cornerstone. We see that in verses 4 and 5. And this morning, as we continue with our series on No God, No Sacrifice, we would want to focus our attention on this title, the Christian's distinction or identity, his duty or function, and his declaration or offering. And all of that is part of the series of studies on Christian sacrifice. There is a survey that was made probably 2 decades ago concerning overseas workers, hindi siguro Filipino lang yung target, probably from other nationalities as well. But in that survey, in that study, the company that was contracted to do that, they aimed to know what is the reason why overseas workers, they experience heartache and heartbreak. Ano ang nakakabasag ng puso ng mga overseas workers? Marami pala. But one common reason why overseas workers' hearts are broken, listen to this, kasi baka na-experience ninyo ito. Unappreciated sacrifice. Nakakabasa ng puso ng overseas workers is the fact that the sacrifice they made, some 5 years, some 10 years, some 20, some the best part of their lives, the sacrifice that they made, go unnoticed, unappreciated. Alam ninyo kung sino ang mga tao na hindi nag-a-appreciate ng sacrifice? Immediate family. Either the spouse or the children. Sometimes the heartache is so deep that overseas workers would choose hindi na lang sila uuwi to spare them from getting hurt so much. Some of the reason why hearts go broken ay dahil after the entire time na nag-sacrifice sila, hindi natupad their dreams, their aspirations were not fulfilled in the lives of their families. They go home after 20 years, poste pa rin ang bahay, unfinished. They go home after 15 years, first year pa rin, college, ang anak. Sacrifices go unappreciated, unnoticed. But what is equally disturbing about this survey is the fact that these overseas workers, tinatanong sila, what do you want to do? They would say, if only they would learn to appreciate, then my heartache, my broken heart will mend if they will learn to appreciate. Sometimes our sacrificial life is affected when our sacrifices go unnoticed. I'm showing you a picture. I'm sure you are all familiar with this. I chose to put this because this is the smallest amount that you are allowed to put inside the red packet. This is the smallest amount that you are allowed to put inside. But it must be multiplied by 10. So kung hindi ka magbibigay ng 10, you need to put in 100. 10 times 10. Some people fully appreciate kung makatanggap sila ng license kahit $10 lang. Yes. It means the world to them. Kahit $10 lang. But has it occurred to you, what can it do if you give it to Mr. Li Ka-shing? I checked the other day how much he is worth. According to Google, he is worth 36.1 billion US dollars. How or what can a 10 Hong Kong dollar do to a person like Mr. Li? So, if you give this red packet to him and he opens it, at makita niya, two things may happen. Either he would say, I really appreciate this, thank you very much, I'll use this sa negosyo ko. Or he would say, ilagay mo lang dyan, and completely forget about it. What will you feel if you are a Christian and you live a sacrificial life? What will you feel if you are a Christian and you sacrificially give? You sacrificially live, you sacrificially serve, and yet your sacrifice goes unnoticed and unappreciated. You may think, ayoko na. I will not sacrifice anymore because no one notices, because what I do goes unappreciated. The Apostle Peter, when he wrote this, he addressed this to strangers. Look at chapter 1, verse 1. These Christians that he called sojourners or strangers, they were believed to be from Rome. They were Christians from Rome. But because of the persecution from the Emperor Nero, they need to escape the persecution. Therefore, this Christians, they were called strangers, They were scattered, sabi dyan sa verse 1, they were scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. They were strangers there. They were not Roman citizens in those places. But also, they were strangers because they were Christians. As they lived in these places mentioned in verse 1, God expects them to live counterculturally. Ibig sabihin, God expected them to go against the tide sa kanilang pamumuhay. God expected them that they would not live as unbelievers do. And part of their countercultural life is sacrificial living. I want to summarize this study by saying that every sacrifice we do to God will be well received only if we offer it up to Him. And you see that very clear in verse 5 where it says, "Ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable or well-received to God by Jesus Christ." There is this relationship between spiritual sacrifices and having them well-received by God. At ito yung key, you offer them up. You bring them up to God as your declaration of thanksgiving. When we do that, your sacrifice will never go unnoticed. When you do that, your sacrificial life to God will be appreciated, will be well received by Him. I need to bring to you three things this morning. The first is this. God favored us. God favored you to have a new distinction. He has given you a new identity. And you see that in verse 5. Once we were unbelievers, but now that we are Christians, we belong to God's family, God has given us a new identity, a new distinction. First of all, we see that He has given us this holy priesthood. This is a privilege to be priests in His spiritual house. You find later on in verse 9 of chapter 2, it is mentioned, ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. God has given us this new identity. He has brought us into His spiritual house. Okay? Oh, may sariling bahay ang Diyos, spiritual house. And we are a part of it now. And the distinction is that each one of us, because we are in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are holy priests. And as priests, we are required to bring to God spiritual sacrifices or offerings. So kung babalikan mo yung picture, wala na pala yung picture natin. Kanina, bato. Balikan na lang natin. One on top of each other, each one of us are living stones in God's spiritual house. But other than that, each one of us are holy priests with one duty, to bring up to God spiritual sacrifices. Now, our identity as holy priests requires each one of us not only to be lively, but to be separate from sin. When you say lively, dynamic, kailangan we must be full of life. Because God has given us life. The Lord Jesus Christ in John 10:10 tells us, "The Son of God, the Son of Man came that you may have life and that you would have life more abundantly." only that we were given life, but we were given abundant life, and we are expected to be dynamic about it, to be lively. Because we need life, we need enthusiasm as we do our sacrifices to God. Kailangan it would be full of life and fervor and zeal as we live sacrificially to God. Pero mahalaga din that we must be separate from sin. And that is what verse 1 tells us. Look at verse 1, mga kapatid. Sabi sa verse 1, so get rid of all evil behavior, be done with all. And here, the Apostle Paul is giving an analogy of soiled clothes that you must put off dahil masyadong marumi, hindi bagay sa iyo. Mga kapatid, as Christians, we live modest lives. Hindi kailangan bago palagi every Sunday. But we see to it na malinis. Planchado. Hindi natin sinusuot yung damit natin simula nung Lunes hanggang Biyernes. We put off soiled clothes. And in verse 1, that is the point of the Apostle Peter, there are things that we must put off because hindi bagay sa atin. Marumi. Now, what are these? First one, all malice. Listen to this. May simple definition ako na ibibigay sa inyo. Malice is the harboring of evil thoughts against another person. Why is malice harmful? Pinapakain ng malice yung lahat na klase ng antagonism. It builds up grudges. Malice secretly hopes revenge, harm, or tragedy will overtake another person. The Apostle Peter says, put off all malice because you cannot find anything beneficial from it if you will sacrificially live for God. You cannot. You want to sacrifice to God and for God, but you have malice in your heart. Your sacrificial living will never be accepted by God. Not only that we must remove all malice, the second thing is all guile. Any form of dishonesty or trickery, we must remove. Listen to this. Guile falsifies income tax returns. Guile cheats on exams. Guile lies about age. Nako. Pati edad. Sakop nito. Guile bribes officials. Guile pulls shady deals in business. We cannot live sacrificial lives for God. We cannot render sacrificial giving or service to God if we have guile. Another thing that we must remove, sabi sa verse 1, all insincerity. I have to put all kasi plural yun eh. Nilagay sa verse 1, hypocrisies. All pretensions. Pretension is, listen. Pretension is pretending to be happily married when his home is actually a battlefield. Tama, no? WWHH sa public, pero mga boxer pagdating sa bahay. What else? All envy. Jerry, I think Jerry Vine gives this definition. Sabi niya, envy is the feeling of displeasure produced by observing or hearing of the advantage or prosperity of others. It is the feeling of displeasure. You are displeased when you see or hear about others being prosperous. In Matthew 27:18, you see that it was envy that caused the chief priests to deliver Jesus up to Pilate para ipako siya eventually sa cross. And so, envy is still a killer. Ito, kinopya ko ito. Pakinggan ninyo, kinopya ko ito. Pakinggan ninyo. We look daggers at others because of their better homes and gardens and smarter clothes or superior cooking. We look daggers. Yung mata mo parang kutsilyo na papatay sa titig mo kasi mas magaling siya magluto kaysa sa'yo. Naglabas mo sa bahay mo, sa neighborhood mo, titigan mo yung kapitbahay mo, masakit titig mo kasi yung garden niya mas maganda kaysa sa garden mo. Yung alumbati niya mas malusog kaysa sa ati mo. Envy! Why is it that we need to put it off? Because it would hinder us from sacrificial living. Yung sacrifice naman sa Panginoon, hindi tapatan eh. Ay, nag-donate siya sa church. 1,000, tapatan ko. Hindi na yung sacrificial living. Contest na yung. And it affects us when we don't remove this, when we don't put this off, ano pa? All slander. Anong example? Backbiting, malicious gossip. Listen to this, kinopya ko ulit. Marami kong kinopya. Listen, slander is the attempt to make oneself look cleaner by throwing mud at someone else. Gusto mo maging pogi ka, maging mas maganda ka, babatuhin mo siya ng putik para maging marumi siya, para mas maging... That is slander. To remove that, if you want to effectively live sacrificially for God. Kasi kung may slander, it defeats the purpose. Why you live sacrificially in the first place? It defeats the purpose. Sisiraan mo ang iba. They were well-intentioned and they were sincere in their sacrificial living or serving or giving, but because you want to destroy them, you want to look good, sisiraan mo siya, it defeats the purpose. Imagine mo, inipon niya ng 1 year. Hindi siya nag-McDo. Hindi uminom ng Coke. Inipon niya. At the end of the year, binigay niya sa Panginoon, sa church. Tapos, dahil nagawa niya at ikaw hindi, sisirahan mo sa sabi mo, nanalo sa sweepstakes. So, slander na. It defeats the purpose of sacrificial living. And so, the Apostle Peter tells us, remove. You see? Remove. There was this guy, Alan Kreider. He wrote a book entitled Journey Towards Holiness. See Mr. Kreider, he leans on the Wesleyan kay John Wesley, Charles Wesley na group. But the Wesleyan thought emphasizes on holiness. Listen to this, because it hurts us. The difference between the Wesleyan thought and the Baptist thought, the Wesleyan thought emphasizes on the holiness part. The Baptist thought emphasizes on discipleship. We have nothing against discipleship. Pero kung minsan, ang emphasis wala sa holiness. Peter again reminds us, put off, and that talks about holiness. Put off. Remove all of this. You want to live sacrificially for God and to God? Remove all of this. Because this will not help you in living sacrificially to God. Ubarin mo ito. Ask God's help. Alisin mo yan. Because you need to. The second thing that we see here, God entrusts you and me with a new duty. There is a function that we must do. And the first function is found in verse 4. Come and be built up. That is the first function. That is our first duty. Come and be built up. Nobody gets built up kung hindi siya lalapit kay Kristo Jesus. I tell you. No Christian will ever grow. No Christian will ever become mature until he comes to God. Until he comes to Him constantly. And this is the duty that God has given each one of us. Verse 4, to whom coming? Sabi sa NLT, sabi, you are coming to Christ. Order for us to be built up in Him, we need to come to Christ. Hindi lang na isang beses to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, but constantly we do it. We come to God every day. We come to His Word. We come to Him in prayer because we want to grow. Which brings us to verse 2. Second duty that God has given us is to be nourished by His Word. We come to God and we are nourished by His Word. Like newborn babies, sabi dyan sa verse 2, you must crave pure spiritual milk so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. But I like this last line. It's a New Living Translation. Cry out for nourishment. Cry out. Wala dito sa King James. Tiningnan ko, wala. Pero sa New Living Translation, meron. Cry out for this nourishment. Because that is what babies do. Kung gutom sila, they cry. How would you know na gutom ang baby mo? How would you know? Narinig mo, umiiyak. Cry out. There are times, and I find this to be true, personally, I find this to be true. There are times when we read God's Word, one or two verses, it seems hindi natin maintindihan. And so we easily give up. One or two verses, I cannot understand anything. Tama na ito bukas naman. You will never grow. You will never get nourishment until you cry out. If it seems na hindi mo naunawaan ang salita ng Diyos, as you read God's Word, what should you do? Cry out to God. God, I come to Your Word today. But it seems I cannot understand this. Please, please, open my eyes so that I can see the truth in Your Word, so that I can identify the promises, so that I can put my hope in it. Please, open my eyes.
Cry out for nourishment.
And you will see the Word of God will nourish you.
We easily give up. We easily give up. Hindi dapat
we cry out for nourishment. Yung baby mo, nung umiyak, nilapitan mo. And this is the promise. If you cry out to God for nourishment, He will come to you. He will make His word clear to you so that you can understand it. Cry out for nourishment. Not only that, you must hope and trust na your spiritual appetite will be stimulated because of God's goodness. Verse 3, it says, verse 3, now that you have had a taste of the Lord's kindness. What stimulates your appetite for spiritual things is the experience of God's goodness upon your life every day.
Yung mga pagkain, appetizer. Diba?
Yung before the main course, yung muna kakainin mo to whet your appetite. Pambansang appetizer, lumpia. Alam mo kung anong spiritual appetizer ng Christian? The goodness of God. Every day you consider, Lord, what are the good things that we have received from you? What are the experiences of your goodness that we have gone through? All of this, mga kapatid, stimulates our appetite for spirit. Why are you here today? Can I ask you this question? Why are you here today? What stimulates your desire? The goodness of God should stimulate our spirit.
When you start to think that God is not good, you will lose your spiritual appetite.
God is good all the time. Huh? We need to remind ourselves of that. Because that is the only thing that would stimulate our spiritual appetite. Now, third. God requires you to make a new declaration. He has given you a new identity and a new duty. But He requires something from you. A declaration of your gratitude to God. Sabi sa verse 5, offer to Him spiritual sacrifices. What does it mean? It means the kind of sacrifices approved by the Holy Spirit. Any sacrifice that you do for God and to God, as long as it is approved by the Holy Spirit, it is considered as a spiritual sacrifice. Your praises, your prayers, your resources, let the Holy Spirit approve it. Not so much the amount, but the motive behind it. Tatanungin mo ang Banal na Espiritu. Banal na Espiritu, would you approve of my motive behind what I will do sacrificially? Because we need to be sure. Baka yung ginagawa natin para sa Panginoon, hindi approved ng Holy Spirit, not counted yun.
I will do this, I will do that para sa sunod na council meeting, top-notch ako.
That is never the motive that is approved by the Holy Spirit. will do this, I will do that, kasi ako lang ang makakagawa. That is not, that will never be approved. Anong sabi? Offer spiritual sacrifices. The kind of sacrifice approved by the Holy Spirit. And so you need to check your motives, your methods, your means. Not only that, you need to offer God gifts acceptable only by way of the Lord Jesus Christ. Sabi dyan sa last part ng verse 5, sabi sa last part ng verse 5, saan na yun? Acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. By way of Him. And so if you do not have a personal relationship with Jesus, anything you do sacrificially would never be accepted by God. It is by the Lord Jesus Christ. It is your response to Him, to what He did for you. Diba? He sacrificed His life, all of His life, hilasmos, and you respond to it with your thusia, that is, by the Lord Jesus Christ. Any sacrifice must be by the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me end this study with a story, a hymn story. One day, Homer Grimes returned to his house. He lived in a public housing. He saw a mother and son coming out of the car. This happened 1930s. It was winter. It was snowing. He found out that this mother and son were selling chestnuts. Alam niyo anong chestnuts? Yung binibenta sa MTR kung umuwi. They were selling chestnuts as their livelihood. Probably because of the cold and because they didn't eat anything that morning, the mother lost consciousness. The son was begging for help. Somebody, please help my mother. This wealthy person came out of his car, took the mother and son. He paid for all the chestnuts, by the way, and gave them extra money. He brought them back home, but before they came to their home, dumaan muna sila sa tindahan and he bought them bread and milk. And when they came out of the car, timing na si Mr. Homer Grimes, dumating siya, nakita niya lang. And he heard this coming from the mouth of the boy. Sir, where do you live? Sagot ng wealthy person, I live on the other side of this town. Sabi ng boy, sir, can I go to your home tomorrow? Because I want to shovel your snow. The boy was just 5 years old, going 6. Probably kung hahawak siya ng pala, mas matanggap pa yung pala niya. But he offered his strength to that man, willing to shovel the snow. Mr. Homer Grimes, umakyat sa kanyang bahay, went straight to his study room, took a pen, piece of paper, he wrote this hymn. The title is, What Shall I Give Thee, Master? Let me read to you the words. What shall I give thee, Master? Thou who didst die for me. Shall I give less of what I possess? Or shall I give all to thee? Here is the chorus. Jesus, my Lord and Savior, thou hast given all for me. Thou didst live thy home above to die. Calvary, What shall I give thee, Master? Thou hast given all for me. Not just a part or half of my heart. I will give all today. Gusto niyo na second stanza? Maganda nang hymn ito. Second stanza. What shall I give thee, Master? Thou hast redeemed my soul. My gift is small, but it is my all. Surrender to thy control. Third stanza. What shall I give thee, Master? Giver of gifts divine. I will not hold time, talents, or gold. For everything shall be thine. If you offer up to God your spiritual sacrifices, it will never go unnoticed. God will appreciate what you do for Him. Let us all stand up, please. Let's pray. We only have one life to offer you, dear God. Our strength is limited, our resources too. But remind us, O Lord, that because we only have one life to live, and despite these limitations we have, we would want to respond with gratefulness to what Jesus did for us. And so we offer to you all that we have. Time, talent, treasure, prayers, our praise, good works, our testimony, everything. As Spirit-approved sacrifices, gifts, tokens of gratitude for you and to you. Not just a part nor half of what we have. Give us grace that we will be willing to give all to you. You are worthy of our all. Bless your word and bless your people. In Jesus' name.
Amen.